Awesome, Peter. Thank you so much for joining me today. I'm so excited to have you on.
You as well. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. So to start off with, tell me your name, your position, and the company you work for.
So my name is Peter Kasper. I'm the founder and CEO of Terpli.
And what is Terpli?
So Terpli is a free mobile app available for iOS and Android, where we interpret batch-specific COAs, or the lab data behind cannabis products, to determine what it will do for users when they consume it. So the aim for Terpli was to try to help users identify which products were best fit for them before they bought them, as opposed to discovering after they bought them.
Yeah, that's super interesting. I think a lot of the advice you see right now for new users is, well, you just gotta try things and find out.
Yep, absolutely.
That can be frustrating for people who don't want to have a bad experience, who don't want to consume too much THC, who don't know what they're getting into.
Or don't want to spend a lot of money on a product they actually don't like.
Yeah, or they just get high and forget to write down how it made them feel.
Cheers, exactly.
So what brought you to starting this app? I'm assuming it had something to do with consumer education.
It absolutely did. And a big part of that was my own education on the industry. So the entire journey is a little bit nerdy, I would say, I guess. So it all started when I was in the MBA program at USC Marshall and had the opportunity to found and lead our first business of cannabis organization called the Marshall Cannabis Association. And as kind of the first person who was in charge of curating all this programming from scratch, I basically had the mentality of, well, I just got to jump headfirst into the industry and just start getting as much exposure as I can, meeting as many people as possible, networking, and really educating myself, because if I'm going to be in charge of educating my fellow classmates, then I have to, you know what I'm talking about here. And it actually all started with a terpene workshop hosted by Kristen Yoder through some kind of a meetup group with Emerald Market here in Los Angeles, the Southern California Cannabis Business Investment Group. And it's there where I learned about, you know, how BS the whole indica sativa hybrid thing was, really how important terpenes were for driving the sensorial experience for cannabis, and also the importance in accessibility of lab testing information or the certificate of analysis behind each cannabis good. It was a way not just to tell how a product was safe to consume and necessary to be sold in the legal market, but also included the full host of cannabinoid information, not just THC and CBD, but all the minor cannabinoids as well, as well as a whole series of different terpenes too. And it was through this where I felt like a light bulb just clicked in my head, where I felt like I came across a roadmap to my high, but it was just in a language I didn't quite understand yet. But understanding at least the power of data and leveraging a lot of my quantitative background, because my background's both in finance and applied mathematics, I saw this just as an opportunity to just jump head first and start analyzing all this information and connecting it to my own experiences with cannabis products. And just out of pure curiosity and passion, I would be that guy that would wait probably up to like 2 hours at a dispensary for some poor bud tender to go in the bag and leaf through some paper copies of COAs just to find maybe the right one for me. Mm-hmm. And it was at that point where I'd say about 30 or so COAs into this process, I'd built my own system for extracting the information, analyzing it, visualizing it, and connecting a lot of dots, where the idea for Terpli really just kind of like spurred, which was other people could value and benefit from the same process that I am right now.
That's really interesting, because I've looked at COAs and they are kind of a different language. My background is
entirely
in nothing scientific, no data analyzing. And when you look at them, you're like, okay, like I see linalool. I don't know what that means. You know, like I recognize these words, but I don't always know what it means from my experience. And as a more experienced user, now I can connect things and understand, you know, oh, I really like this terpene, you know, this terpene is going to put me to sleep, whatever. But when you're first looking at them, particularly as a new user, it's an incredibly overwhelming amount of data.
Entirely, entirely so. And that's actually been a huge part of this journey as well, because for more experienced users, we might have the interest and the drive to look at some really convoluted, overwhelming piece of lab data and try to piece together some understanding and connect those dots. Mm-hmm. But we are not the average consumer. the average consumer is still unfamiliar with what even a terpene is. And most of the time talking about this stuff will just go far over their head. And yeah. So how you can take this information and more distill it down to digestible bits of actually usable and valuable information is really one of the things that I was set out to do and try to really bring to the forefront of a consumer's experience.
Yeah, absolutely. There's a huge push for education right now because all of a sudden people are realizing it's not just about THC. It's not just about how high can you get, how fast can you get high. It's about what is this cannabinoid going to make me feel? How is this going to help me? What cannabinoid in this plant is actually best suited for what I'm looking for?
No, exactly. I mean, I think it all comes down to the quality of the high, which is more what people are using or looking for. And I feel like you have the consumers that just want to get high. Like that absolutely exists. But that is far less of a demographic of user than I think most people realize, where there's so many other more diverse and creative ways that people like to consume cannabis to enrich their lives, be that through having a more creative edge with work, having a more in tune workout with themselves to be able to kind of push their boundaries more, or even just to relax and unwind, but without having a, you know, feeling like their brain is going to the moon.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. It's distilling down the information that I think we in the industry get so accustomed to seeing every day is really the key to pushing the whole industry forward and moving beyond this THC, indica, sativa divide.
You are just speaking my language here.
I am all about this. I have some people in my circle who's had a bad experience with THC, and it really turned them off of cannabis entirely because it was all they knew. So when I was able to say, hey, try this cannabinoid instead, try CBD, try CBG, it was like, oh, I don't just have to go to the moon. I can just feel the way I want to feel.
Exactly. I mean, it's been so great. I mean, especially educating my parents and my family. And I definitely consider myself more of the black sheep when it comes to my journey through cannabis and kind of my exposure and just involvement and passion for it. But it's been really remarkable getting to kind of educate my parents and my siblings about the value of CBD and CBG and CBN and all these other types of formulations and companies that are also doing incredible things that have products with really, really incredible therapeutic value that doesn't involve getting high.
Yeah, absolutely. So what was your journey into cannabis like?
Oh man, so it's always been kind of a cultural communal thing for me, really. I mean, it's been one of those elements where going through high school and undergrad, there was a group of people that loved to go and get drunk and kind of party like that. And I wasn't really a part of that crowd as much. I was more the, hey, let's go share a joint in the car while listening to some music and just like have some, you know, giggle fest and just laugh a bunch about, you know, how we're feeling and the different kinds of conversations that we can have and spur as a result of this. And I just fell in love with that environment. And it really started to shape a lot of my core friendships and a lot of the things that I just love doing and enjoying with my friends. A big part of this too is also I have ADHD and I've taken medication for most of my life with it. And cannabis has also provided a lot of relief in terms of some of the side effects with medication and even understanding and becoming curious with why do I feel more anxious when I consume this when I'm on ADHD medication versus feeling more uplifted and stimulated when I'm not on the medication. And the differences in my effects and feelings depending on state of being was such a curious point for myself where I really started to want to understand and research how different products and different environments can then lead to different outcomes.
Yeah, absolutely. A lot of people don't talk about the environment and how important it is when you're consuming cannabis. You hear a lot about it in psychedelics, like the setting needs to be right, but it has a really big impact on your cannabis experience as well.
Absolutely. I mean, it's one of the bigger factors for sure. I mean, I've definitely found that certain products will give more of a streamlined or baseline feeling or effect when you consume them, but depending on a variety of different situations, like you might be with people that you've never met before, and all of a sudden you might have all these different kinds of social barriers or stigmas that might pop up in your head about, oh, maybe I don't want to, maybe I have some social anxiety, or maybe I don't want to like come off a certain way. And then that will kind of interact with cannabis's effect on you, which might lead to a more anxious experience or whatever it might be. But the more aware you can be of these different external and environmental factors, I think the more you can then start to design and even cater your cannabis experience to really complement these different contexts.
Yeah, absolutely. Figuring out what is appropriate for what setting, because you don't necessarily want to be super high meeting new people for the first time, but you know, maybe some CBD will help take the edge off.
Yeah, absolutely so. And I mean, even just some CBD THC mix of flower where you're not having the same kind of anxiety, or even just like understanding where the different cannabinoids fit within your life, I think has so much value and potential. And this is also touches on the value of terpenes too. Mm-hmm. Just both separate from cannabinoids as well as in conjunction with them, and how you can unlock so much therapeutic value depending on really just a further understanding of yourself as well as how these can really benefit your life.
Yeah, absolutely. What you're touching on there is the entourage effect and how all of these chemical compounds really interact to provide a better experience than these isolated cannabinoids could.
Bingo.
Super, super important, I think, for people to understand, especially people who are using for the first time, because they might think, oh, pure CBD going to give me exactly what I need, but they're actually looking for that CBD plus terpene blend.
Yep, exactly. And I think a big way too is I've such a big fan of Dr. Ethan Russo and pretty much follow everything that he does in regards to his various podcasts, interviews, his various research journals. And mm-hmm. it's been such a big inspiration for myself, both in regards to not just understanding what we get today from a research perspective, but also how much more there is to understand going forward. And one of my favorite, discoveries he has was that just having a little bit of CBD increases your threshold or tolerance for THC. Mm-hmm. And even so, the value of CBD or THC can help amplify the therapeutic effects of CBD as well. And that kind of interrelationship between them, and that's just looking at two of the cannabinoids, and there's over like 150 that exist in the plant. And we still only test for like maybe 15 to 20 at this point right now. Mm-hmm. Like there's so much left to be discovered here that it's just, it gives me so much passion and energy just thinking about how much there is to discover and the potential for being a part in what we understand and how it can benefit everyone's lives.
Yeah, absolutely. We are literally just scratching the surface of this intensely complex plant that we don't fully understand how it interacts with us or why it interacts with us the way that it does, or why it has all of these medicinal benefits.
It's amazing.
It really is. So what are you most excited to see in the industry right now?
Oh, it really has been this evolution of terpenes and cannabinoids just kind of becoming more at the forefront of what people think and talk about and really what drives the experience for individuals and operators in the space. There was a really awesome article by the Rolling Stones a bit ago about a future with terpenes kind of driving a lot of the experiences for users. And it was a little bit reminiscent in a kind of dystopic way of this book called Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep, which is what the movie Blade Runner is based off of. Mm-hmm. But it's essentially starts with like this element where these people in this book or in this world kind of have these like almost, it seems so much like terpene blends, but they'll go to their front door and there'll be a little like mist that sprays that they can determine how they want to feel for the day. They want to feel more upbeat because they have some kind of a presentation they have to give, or if they have to go like work for 8 hours straight in like a model kind of building capacity, they have like a focus blend that they then kind of spray in their face that just sets the mood for the day. And the book paints a more dystopic picture for it, but I see a lot of ways where, especially considering how natural this fits in with our endocannabinoid system, how you really people can leverage this for the benefit of whatever they want it to be it having a blend of CBN and linalool that will spray like as they go to bed at night to have them have a more relaxing and kind of easygoing night or transition into rest or something like that. But it's the ways that we can leverage these in kind of minor capacities to just kind of take the edge off or even get you in a better mood for whatever it is that you might be trying to do.
Yeah, absolutely. I feel like you're touching on using these cannabinoids and terpenes for preventative care and bettering our health rather than just reactive care, like our current medical system is set up for.
Absolutely. I mean, it definitely fits in with spot on. Absolutely spot on.
It's really interesting to be in this industry and to have an understanding of what we don't know and what it means for our system going forward. Because we're up to our ears in it every day. And I want to spray it like a fire hose on everybody that I know. And they're not interested in learning about it. And I'm like, no, you don't understand. This is going to change everything.
I know. So I was thinking about this or talking with a friend about this earlier. There's this show called What We Do in the Shadows, which is about basically like ancient vampires trying to adjust to life in modern day New York. Yeah. And it's like a hilarious comedy, but they have this one type of character called an energy vampire, which is able to go out into the world during the day. But basically one of the main characters is an energy vampire, and he looks like your average office accountant, like bald head. He just goes around and he just like, they, instead of a vampire getting energy from sucking blood, energy vampires get energy from sucking your energy. So they just bore you. They just make it as boring as possible. They take in all of your energy and they just drain you. And it resembles every single kind of, you know, office accountant who just wants to talk about the weather with you. And you're like, oh my God. But they introduced this new character in the latest season as an energy vampire who is just a huge cannabis enthusiast. And all he talks about with people are cannabinoids and terpenes and just the different types of cannabis.
Oh, that's embarrassing and spot on.
It's just so funny because I feel like if you're in the industry and you get it, then like you can talk about it all day. Mm-hmm. But if you're not, people are like, oh my God, I just do not care. Like,
yes, like, please shut up. Can we change the subject?
So how to navigate that line, especially as I've gone headfirst in the deep end of cannabis, and a lot of my friends haven't necessarily. And mm-hmm. I've learned that not all of them want to know everything about cannabis that I want to share with them.
Yeah, it's hard. I'm fortunate to have a partner who is interested in cannabis, so he absorbs all of these new discoveries that I make every day
as amazing
service. But my family is like, how's work? All right, that's enough.
Oh my.
So as you've been in the industry, as you've been building this app, making connections, getting to know people, what is one thing you see happening in the industry that you think we really need to shift away from?
So definitely it feels bad having like just keep drilling into this point, but it's really the indica sativa hybrid, you know, dynamic. Mm-hmm. It's the obsession with THC percentages. I mean, it's causing so many issues within the space where, what I've really found is that operators have to play down to the lowest education level of the consumer in order to sell them products. And the lowest education level is indica sativa. It's what is the highest THC percent? What will get me the highest, blah, blah, blah. And if that's what people are buying off of, that's also what's going to be driving prices, what's driving demand, and what's going to be encouraging operators to continue feeding that type of practice. And as a result of that, because they don't want to, at least the ones that have put forward marketing and resources towards educating consumers, they haven't gotten the return that they thought they would. Mm-hmm. And there's so many people who just aren't really picking up on that or even care to pick up on that in general. And as a result, it just keeps wedging individuals into, if your product isn't above 20% THC, it won't even fit on shelves for retailers necessarily. Mm-hmm. And something that I've talked about previously with some other friends as well, and other ideas I've had, is like in a business setting, like I don't want to smoke 20%+ THC, or if someone's like, oh, I have the best like 45% cannabinoids, 35%+ THC. I'm like, that sounds great for me by myself when I'm alone, not with other people, mm-hmm. because I'm not going to be able to function if I consume that. And having like, my dream was to have like super low THC joints or something that you can just like puff on in a business setting where it doesn't just blast you out of capacity, but you can just kind of functionally chill there and, you know, have a good time and share it with people and not feel like mm-hmm. you're unable to function. But it's really getting to explore the different ways that, you know, cannabis can really unlock therapeutic and value for users everywhere. And I mean, one of my favorite things is going in and asking what this lowest THC percent product is, because it's usually going to be some awesome product that is much cheaper than everything else because they don't think it's going to sell quite as well. Mm-hmm. But I think it's really departing from that kind of stigma or expectation that THC is king and really starting to explore these other components, which really drive more of the quality for the high.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. Yeah, I've been in dispensaries where I'm looking over their list and I'm like 20% THC, 20, like, do you guys sell anything that has CBD in here? And they're like, oh yeah, we have one pre-rolled joint that you can buy that's like a blend. And I think a lot of it comes down to what you were saying earlier, that prototype of who people who smoke cannabis are, that stoner who wants to get high, who wants to just chill on the couch. But there's a very large emerging market of people who don't want to do that, but they want to find how they can blend cannabis into their lives. And it's not with 20% plus THC, because it doesn't work for so many people.
No, not at all. And I mean, this is simply also touching on the recreational consumer, not even the medical consumer who might need cannabis just to function in a work environment, but now only has options, or at least is very limited options, to anything that would allow them to work functionally in that kind of an environment. Mm-hmm. And how you can cater to both sides of things and really use this as a medicinal plant as well as a recreational one is so important and something I think is really lacking in the space.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, for the medicinal consumer to not have that availability of other cannabinoids at their fingertips, when we know these other cannabinoids can have a really positive effect, like helping us sleep, helping us fight cancer, helping us fight free radicals in our body, but they're stuck with THC because that's what the recreational consumer wants.
Exactly. And this lack of diversity and product types and everything, like there's a great book called Cannabis Pharmacy that really walks through the history of why we're stuck with such high THC products. And really, as a result of the war on drugs, having a limited availability of products or environments to grow cannabis in, and having the biggest kind of bang for your buck from a THC perspective. I mean, we had to have products that were great to be grown in small, cramped, dark environments, like a closet, things that could have really high THC, so you didn't need a lot of the product to consume if you wanted to get the therapeutic value. But as a result, a lot of different genetics and strains have been lost through just time, given the fact that there was an inability to even grow them. So I know there's a variety of companies that are kind of doing genetic restoration projects on old seeds and other things like that to try to kind of restore these old kind of like chemotypes and things back to the market. And that's really exciting for me, because you think about how fragmented the markets are, how each respective state or even location in the world has had to have their own cannabis grown in a completely unique and separate environment, which means that there's completely unique and diverse strains all over the place. And even the word strain is not really accurate anymore in terms of representing what these products are. But in terms of just the diversity of things, it's exciting thinking about 10, 20 years from now, what will be available on shelves and what types of experiences these can really cater towards.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think you touched on something important. They're talking about how they're not really strains. Strains are for diseases and viruses. They're cultivars. But so much of the language that we use to talk about cannabis is very clumsy, because we don't have a lot of language to address specifics. You know, hemp, cannabis, marijuana, weed, they all kind of incorporate the same thing.
Exactly. I mean, I think the way that we can, I mean, it also touches on the aspect of standardization in the space and really the lack thereof when it comes to testing standards, when it comes to the language that we're using to even describe the products that we're talking about itself. I mean, there's so much room for improvement in that area. And it almost feels like we have all these disjointed efforts, no pun intended, in regards to how we're trying to really tackle the same issue, but without any kind of unifying board or standardization, it just becomes a challenge, because someone may try to do it and then someone else in a different part of the world is going to try in the exact same way, but with a different methodology. Now, all of a sudden we have two competing types of trains of thought here. And how do you even wrestle with that when you have, I don't know, no kind of connection between how people are doing things?
Yeah, absolutely. There's a very large educational barrier to overcome, not just for new consumers, but for people who are in the industry too, and might be accustomed to talking about it as marijuana, to learn that, you know, that word came from derogatory origins. And a lot of people in the industry want to move away from it, because it kind of gives the same vibe as like calling alcohol hooch when it was illegal in the 30s. Oh,
exactly. But then all of a sudden you see that like marijuana is like baked into the Colorado legislation for how they talk about the regulations for it. And you're like, how do you fix this? Like, this goes back so far and it's so deeply ingrained. And you're trying to convince people who are of older generations to be changing the language for it when that's just how they've addressed it their whole lives.
Yeah. They don't want to be told to change their language when they were the ones spearheading this fight to begin with.
Exactly. So yeah. I feel like it's another one of those things that's kind of up to our generation to try to solve and really being to the forefront of what matters and what should be, you know, prioritized going forward.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm going to put you on the hot seat real quick. I have a question about diversity and inclusion. And I think coming from an MBA program and working with, as I was scrolling your website, it seems like your team is a lot of white men. I'm curious how you approach keeping people who were in the legacy market and who paid the price for the legacy market included in the legal market going forward.
Yeah, so unfortunately our website is super outdated. Most of the individuals with the key hires there are actually no longer still with the company as of right now. Okay. But as of right now, our team consists of one developer who is white, and then a social strategist who's Black, and then a data scientist who is from Singapore as well. And so we're definitely trying to leverage at least just more diverse practices when it comes to our hiring. And I think so much of it comes down to just prioritizing that, where kind of at the first, at least forefront of when I first launched, it was definitely a need-based hiring. I had an idea, I had very little resources, and I needed to move quickly for it. And as we've been kind of going down this path, it's become more of, we've had more flexibility and availability to have more diverse hiring practices in place and really to prioritize things I see as important, which is hiring women, which is hiring people of color, and trying to just really instill that as an ingraining culture within the company that we're going or we're building moving forward. I think so much of it comes down to just a choice. And really trying to just instill that as how you're trying to build up a company and a culture that you're proud of and want to have.
Yeah, absolutely. And I don't bring that up to, you know, make you rattle off the races of the people who work for you, but rather to just encourage the conversation. Because I think a lot of times it can be something that's uncomfortable to address. But when we start to talk about it more, when we start to say, this is something that I'm looking at, this is something that we're prioritizing moving forward, it's easier to say, okay, well, we see how we can instill these changes moving forward and in other companies around us as well.
Yeah, absolutely. But especially as we continue to grow, I think just ensuring that that's in kind of the fabric of how we hire people, of the culture we want to have. There's an opportunity at such an early stage to really build that into it. And it's one of those things that I'm actually pretty excited about going forward and having that opportunity as kind of the hiring manager to decide what's important for our company and what we want to uphold for cultural values.
Yeah. Absolutely. I think you touched on a really good point there, that these things really are set at the forefront of your company. And when you're intentional about making them a priority, then they get baked into your culture.
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. So as you built this app, as you built this company, what is the biggest challenge that you've overcome?
Man, I really think just speed to market has been a really big one for ourselves, and trying to just get something out there that currently doesn't exist right now. There's been so many different people who've tried to build up what we're doing, especially over the last 10 or so years. This definitely isn't a new idea in no way, but I think right now presents a unique window of opportunity to really see it succeed and execute on it properly, especially with the advent of more far spread testing for terpenes, mm-hmm. as the testing for just equipment becomes more robust and you start to see more availability of minor cannabinoids, of other terpenes that are at play here. It really creates this opportunity to track what works for people, how you can correlate different types of elements here and really trace it towards user outcomes. Mm-hmm. And I'm looking at this from such a data kind of mathematical perspective. Like, I'm not a scientist, so I'm not able to tell you exactly how each of the terpenes and cannabinoids fit together and kind of like work and operate within our body, especially because there's pretty limited knowledge already when it comes to how they interact, especially synergistically together. But from a mathematical perspective, these are just a bunch of variables that you can trace together to lead to an outcome perspective. And that in and of itself is really exciting for me. But getting to actually get a team together, build up a product that might be able to fit within this certain type of value proposition. And despite having a little bit of turbulence in regards to really seeing the right product fit within the market and seeing what will actually stick with consumers, since it's such a changing and evolving landscape, I think just getting a product to market and getting to just receive the flood of feedback and support from the market in terms of the problem that we're solving and really the value we can provide has been not just one of the bigger, I guess, hurdles, but also one of the most inspiring parts of what I'm doing.
That's awesome. There is, yeah, a lot of people have tried to put together a really collective database on cannabis and its effects, but it has felt seemingly impossible to put all that data together. So I think there's something to be said for taking a mathematical perspective rather than, you know, a scientific or a content aggregating perspective to see them as just variables that line up, whereas, you know, scientists will see them as an overwhelming amount of chemicals and molecules that we don't have enough data for.
I mean, there's so much left to be discovered and explored when it comes to cannabis. And really one of the bigger things that I've found out from going through this journey is that everyone's different. Mm-hmm. Everyone is affected uniquely by it. I've worked closely with Len May from EndoDNA, at least just been such a big fan of kind of his work and what he's building over there with the company. And he just recently launched the book Cannabis is Personal. And it's just so, it's so true. And especially through the data that we've found from our users, what they've been reviewing, it's that cannabis really does affect everyone uniquely. But as a result of that, it's no longer about how do we then create some unified understanding to apply as a blanket across all the users, but how do we then make their experience so personalized that instead they can go into a dispensary and have a unique catered selection of products available to them based off of their preferences, which is unique individual by individual.
That would be awesome. That's the dream, isn't it?
That's the goal.
To walk in and say, oh, Peter, hello. We have your selection over here of things we think you would like.
Exactly. I mean, getting to custom sort an entire inventory and really choose like firsthand, oh, because you've loved these products for sleep, these are the ones that are best for that. These are the ones that are best for your exercise. This is best for unwinding and relaxing, socializing. Mm-hmm. Like that is really what's been driving me forward and one of the biggest things that I'm passionate about creating.
Yeah, absolutely. So a lot of what you do centered around consumer education, of course. If you were talking to somebody who were to try cannabis for the first time, what is one piece of advice you would give them?
Check the package date.
Okay.
Like, check the package date. I mean, that in and of itself is the first that, like, yeah, terpenes, cannabinoids are extremely important for driving the experience, but they also degrade extremely quickly in especially different conditions and environments. A lot of the times, a lab testing information will be completely obsolete if you look at a product that's six to nine months out from when it was properly packaged. And a lot of times, you're just going to get a straight like THC high off of an experience. But if you really want a unique blend, you really want to have everything the product has to offer for you. I mean, you really got to check the package date to make sure that within 1 to 3 months that you're actually getting a product that's fresh. I think there really is a shelf life and it's an extremely fickle product too. And so how you can then really cater to that and get the experience the plant was designed to give to a consumer is one of the first starting points.
Yeah, absolutely. That is a great piece of advice because how much surplus cannabis do we have on the shelves right now? I mean, how much cannabis is being thrown out because there's not enough consumers to keep up with supply? How much of it is just sitting in warehouses until it finally gets shipped? Some of it's
exactly.
Old. So as you look at the industry, 10 years down the line, pretty much impossible to predict where we're going to be. But where do you see the industry in like 3 to 5 years?
I definitely see education driving a much more important role in the things. Terpenes and minor cannabinoids being much more important, especially when it comes to some of the more accessible products for early consumers. So I'm thinking a lot of edibles in that case. I mean, nowadays, like you see CBN is good for sleep, and then all of a sudden edible companies are having these CBN and THC blends that you can have. But given the fact that there's still limited research, you start seeing, oh, this also has some melatonin in it or mm-hmm. some other components where it's like, oh, it's THC, CBG, and a little bit of caffeine for more of an uplifting kind of effect. And it's like, okay, well, I feel like they're kind of forcing this classic sativa feeling or classic indica by having these other external components layered into it. But I think as we become more aware of the value of these components, then it will definitely start to drive newer, more innovative products, especially as research starts to prove or at least lead directionally into the therapeutic value that they can yield. With that in mind, what I hope is more kind of designer cannabis, where people start to understand with unique cultivation practices or manufacturing processes, how to really optimize certain chemotypes within the plant itself, how to then create something that's very high in alpha pinene or these other components like linalool and really drive more unique experiences separate from just a really dominant THC myrcene kind of a high. And that's personally what I'm really excited about. But I think more of awareness will start to drive more of the experimentation, but it's also a balance between what consumers are willing to open themselves up to and become educated by, and then how that can drive purchasing patterns.
Yeah, absolutely. I love that you touched on designer cannabis, because I think that something that is going to help with that is the spread of cannabis across the country, the legalization, because so much of what we have right now is driven by West Coast cannabis and what grows really well out there. I'm from upstate New York. The same kind of cannabis we're going to grow is not going to be what you guys have out there, because our climate is really different. So I think it'll be exciting too, as you see it, cannabis popping up across the country. What grows well in California is different than Michigan, is different than New York, and is different than Florida. So you'll start to get these like regionally specific ones too.
And that also touches on the advent of interstate commerce and how the availability of distribution for different products from across markets will just really open up more diversity when it comes to product selection. And that is something I'm very excited about. I mean, getting to really have a sample of Oregon's finest, Washington's finest, California's, just New York, like it'll be crazy and massively disruptive, both towards the way that people currently grow within their own markets, but also to the current MSOs that exist in the field right now. And the whole topic around, you know, if MSO just bought a multi-million dollar cultivation facility and they're currently building that up, then all of a sudden they're now competing with really cheap Oregon cannabis products, then that's an entirely disruptive element here that's going to topple over the current infrastructure right now. And what that will look like is pretty exciting to me. I mean, it's such a dynamic space right now, and it really spells so much uncertainty for the future, but I have my popcorn.
Yeah, from an industry perspective, it's kind of like, oh, that's going to be interesting. But from a consumer's perspective, it's going to be exactly what we need to really push these different cultivars and these different experiences to the forefront, getting beyond just THC.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's going to be awesome when you can like sit on your computer, order like some weed from Oregon, have it shipped to you in Virginia.
Oh my God, I love the idea.
What a future. It's exciting to see now that things are picking up steam, how quickly things are changing. Because I think 5 or 6 years ago, people would have been like, yeah, you know, it started, but we'll see in 10 years. And now we're like, let's go.
I mean, they talk about cannabis years being like dog years. Like it really moves so rapidly and quickly. And just in my 2+ years since really diving headfirst into this space, I've already seen so much dramatic change. And mm-hmm. One of the bigger elements was also brands having more awareness and kind of accessibility for lab testing data. And when I first started, Raw Garden was the very first brand that I started getting exposure to, because every single product had a QR code that linked to their lab testing. Oh. And nowadays, I mean, so again, from the perspective of someone who would wait up to 2 hours in a dispensary just for a paper copy of a PDF, it basically led to this point where now I can go into a dispensary and say, hey, what brands have the QR code on the product? And they can give me 7, 8, 9 different brands all laid out for me that I can just scan and check out the different products and really choose what kind of selection that I want to have.
That's awesome. That goes a long way to being able to kind of vote with your dollars towards what you want from your cannabis companies.
Exactly. And it's one of those things where I feel like if that can drive the way that consumers purchase products, and that's also an indicator of how consumers enjoy, or at least we get the feedback of what types of chemical profiles best mesh with consumers, which ones don't, mm-hmm. That does nothing but then just weed out the products that no one likes,
yeah.
Which is better for everyone. Like, why does an operator want to make products that no one enjoys? And why do consumers want to buy a product that they're not going to like? Mm-hmm. It just feels like a win-win for everybody.
Yeah, absolutely. When we not only have that data, but we understand it, then it becomes actionable.
Exactly. Yeah.
So as you're rolling your app out and you're helping consumers curate their perfect cannabis experience, what do you really want somebody to take away from using your app?
That you can design cannabis for a variety of different contexts, that there's more than just getting high, and really THC isn't king here. It's really about the outcome from the experience. It's THC is alcohol percentage and everyone's going for Everclear right now. I really think if you can design it to cater to specific effects, cater to specific experiences, then all of a sudden it really just opens up the door to all these different kind of rich opportunities for individuals. And something that I like to call like conscious cannabis, where you're instead using or consuming cannabis to consciously cater towards specific environments or experiences in a way that adds value to you. You're not just getting high, but you're trying to enrich certain facet of what you're doing. And I've gotten so much value personally from exploring and really looking at cannabis in that kind of light. And I just think everyone should.
I love that you said conscious cannabis use. I think the intention that you go into it with does play a big part, and understanding what each cultivar or cannabinoid will do to you goes a really long way to having a conscious, enjoyable experience every time.
Completely agree.
And THC is not king. I want to put that on a poster and just like parade around with it. THC is not king. It's not the only thing you should be concerned about.
Not at all. And I know the Kenigma has such a wonderful, they've got so many great stickers coming out for MJ Biz. I just saw on LinkedIn pretty recently about like strains or viruses, like chemovars of the future, that THC isn't king and all this stuff. I'm like, I want to get every single sticker and just put it on everything I own.
Yes, I'll just cover my laptop in them. So anytime anybody asks me something, I can just show them and be like, start here, start right here. This has been such a phenomenal conversation, and I've so enjoyed spending time with you. I have one last question for you today.
Shoot.
What is your favorite fun fact about cannabis?
My favorite fun fact? I mean, it's the fact that we've evolved physiologically with this plant. That for something that was so shunned, that was seen as wrong, has such an important and key and built-in functionality into our body through the endocannabinoid system that really all we have to do now going forward with this awareness is unlock the potential. But it's the fact that we've literally evolved with this, that other species on this planet have evolved with it too, as they also have this. Like, it's kind of magical when you think about it in that kind of light, and it makes it seem like such a natural fit for having a relationship with it and all the ways that it can really enrich our lives and benefit people. It just seems like it has unlimited and infinite potential. And we're now at this unique period where we really can start to research, explore, and uncover its benefits. And this also comes down to, I mean, kind of branches on the element of psychedelics too, in terms of how we've kind of have this whole relationship and evolution with various psychedelic plants as well. And just being on the precipice there is another whole area that I'm incredibly excited to continue seeing research on, because the therapeutic potential is undeniable.
Yeah, absolutely. It is undeniable. I only learned about my endocannabinoid system earlier this year, and it just completely reinvented what I thought I understood about cannabis. How can this plant be evil if there's a system in my body made to process it, made to maximize its benefits?
Absolutely. So, more to come. I'm eagerly watching all research that comes out about this and hoping to contribute to that research someday with Terpli as well. So yeah, the future is exciting.
It really is. Thank you so much for your time, Peter. This has been fantastic.
Thank you so much, Jessica.